In those days, a decree went out from the Emperor Augustus that said that all the world should be registered. And so all went to the land of their birth to sign up for the registry. I remember the days when I was just about to give birth. Now, most of you didn't know me in those days, but I was serving a wonderful and humble church in San Diego, a church that had very little time to give me some space to have a child, and so I had limited days that I might be able to be with her. She turned out to be a girl. Limited days that I would be able to be with her, so I tried to postpone my maternity leave as long as I possibly could, so that I could have all of my time with her after she was born. Which means that, I'm going to admit to you, in the last few weeks of my pregnancy, my church didn't get my very best. As I would come and I would waddle into church in my flip-flops. It was San Diego, so I could get away with that. And as loose of a dress as I could muster, maybe having had a shower, I would sit, and I would listen to people, and I would think, what you are saying is the most important thing I can possibly hear right now. But I just wonder when you're going to stop talking so that I can get to the bathroom. Because you know what happens, the baby sits right there on the woman's bladder. So how on earth did Mary get up 3 days before she was due to give birth and travel all the 102 miles as the crow flies to give birth to Jesus? This I cannot imagine. And yet this is what was asked of her by the decree of the Emperor Augustus. And I want to talk a little bit about that decree, because what he was doing under the reign or the governorship of Quirinius of Syria, and Syria, by the way, the word Syria that appears in the Bible included the Holy Land in these days. So this group of Syrians were asked to uproot themselves if their lives took them to a place of better opportunity and go back to their homelands, which might be very far away, which might deprive the women in a state of giving birth or having just given birth from being able to have those special last days of nesting. Nesting, by the way, if you talk to any midwife, is one of the great signs that a baby is about to come. And I remember my nesting days. I knew I had a meeting coming. I knew someone's deep pastoral need was going to be in front of me. But instead, all I could think about was the paint color on the wall. Or how we hadn't quite, I hadn't been able to convince my husband to finish constructing that last piece of furniture. But I just felt like I couldn't even think of anything else if he didn't just finish that last IKEA thing. And we know how this is. Mary didn't get to have her IKEA thing. And these people in the land of Syria were not able to have their IKEA thing. Instead, they had to follow the emperor. And why would you do this? Why would the emperor ask for such a registry? Now, in Roman times, a census was really a way of collecting information on the people so that than anything else, they could tax people. So it's not like it was ever going to be good news. Because the census would give the Romans a stronger count of how many people were in a household, who the husband and the wife were, because that was what the configuration was back then, how many children they had, how many oxen and asses, not the kind we usually talk about, but the ones that count for taxes. How many of all the sorts of livestock were part of the households that the Romans knew in a community, how much money to expect from the town of Nazareth, the town of Bethlehem, the town of Galilee. If you weren't there to be counted, then you were in breach of the law. So yes, of course, the Holy Family would uproot themselves. This was a way for the empire to say who was in and who was out, and who was on top and who was at the bottom, so that they would know very carefully. And what we see from the biblical text is that as they started to collect this kind of information, people became more vulnerable, as is the case often with registries given to the wrong hands. We've been talking quite a bit these days about registries, haven't we? We've been talking about collecting a name of Muslims. I got a phone call today as a warning. I don't really watch the news. I read the news, but I don't watch it. Apparently all over the television news, there was talk about how dangerous it would be to go to church today. Did anyone see this? By a show of hands? So I missed this, but thank God I have a mother, because she wanted to be sure I knew. And Mom called me and she said, it's all over the news. ISIS has put out whatever against churches, and they've asked that churches be attacked for Christmas, and you should just know that maybe some fewer people will be showing up. And that winds up being very attractive to cover on the news, doesn't it? Because it engenders within us the kind of sense of fear that makes us start to wonder, well, maybe it would be good to know who all the Muslims are. Maybe it would be helpful if there were a list of who they were so that we could give them a call the next time something happens. We could round them up, maybe, and get them to come into an office and ask them some questions, and we wouldn't have to wonder who they were because we have their names, thank goodness. The problem with such a list is not necessarily that it's collected, it's what's done with it and who has access to it. And this, my friends, is where I am afraid. I'm not afraid of ISIS. I came and walked right up in this church proudly, not worried because I know I am protected by God. But I am worried for my Muslim brothers and sisters who already have begun to be counted. There's already a registry of Muslims. They had to go show up at offices and give their names. And 83,000 Muslims were collected, their names. They sent in surveillance, they sent in spies. There were cameras on every mosque in Brooklyn and in Queens. They sent people in and pretended to be converts so that they could know more. They sent spies into restaurants and into the schools and into the masjid and into every gathering, thinking that they might collect something, and out of this entire registry and surveillance program, nothing turned up in the 15 years after 9/11 that it was in place. And yet, they would have us think that in the midst of threat, that this is the solution, a registry. The kind of registry that will pull people away from their places of safety and their homes and their ability to nest and their ability to thrive and to give birth in a safe way. And instead, it makes a few people feel better. And as we learn in the gospel story about this time in which the birth of Christ happened, in a time of great danger for his family, and it would only get worse, the gospel then tells us that there were shepherds lying in the fields, keeping watch over their sheep. Now think about this keeping watch in the context of surveillance. Because the empire surveils its people so that it can control them. But God, Jesus Christ, who is born as the good shepherd, is born to come and keep watch over us. Not to control us, but to allow us to live safely. always protected from ultimate harm. And that, my friends, is a key difference. And so that means that even if we stumble or we fall or we get lost on whatever path we find ourselves on, God will never lose us. Amen? God will never lose us. And for that form of keeping watch, for the kind of comfort and protection and care and love that can say no matter what you do or no matter what you think or no matter what you believe, you are protected and safe and beloved and whole and beautiful and gorgeous and everything I intended you to be when you were born, God says to us. For that kind of a love, sign me up.